My name is Mike Snody. I make knives. Hey guys, it's Mike Snody coming to you from my South Texas knife shop. Thank you for supporting Snody Knives and thank you for watching our videos. Guys, I've got an exciting operation to share with you today. I'm going to show you how we build the Snody Boss, the Snody Bug Out Special. Guys, this is a great opportunity for you to learn how to build a handmade knife that will really serve you well as a utility bushcraft tactical type blade, the Snody Boss. The first thing we do is start out with a 6-foot bar of steel. And this is how the steel comes into me from the mill. 6 foot long, 1 inch wide, and 1/8 inch thick. This steel is currently in the annealed state, which means it's soft. It's about 45 Rockwell, which means we can drill it, we can cut it. We're gonna take our template, lay it on top of the bar, and get it lined up here. It just barely fits, that's what we want. We don't wanna waste any material. Take two of your clamps, clamp it down. A lot of people purchase scribes. We actually make our own tools here in the shop, and this is CPM 420V, run up to about 65 Rockwell, and it cuts into this steel effortlessly. It gives me a very precise line that I will later follow with my saw and grinder outside. Guys, this is what handmade knives are all about. They're handmade. We draw them on a piece of paper. We build the initial prototype. That's this pattern right here. We transfer the stencil to a piece of steel, and then we walk over to a saw and cut it. So I'm going to take you to the saw. We're going to cut this, and then we're going to take it outside. I'm going to show you how to grind this profile. I'm going to show you how easy it is to build your own handmade knife, guys. So the next step in this operation is going to be to cut this knife blade to length. And to perform that operation, I'm going to use our metal cutting bandsaw. Guys, something to keep in mind when you're purchasing your blade for your saw is more teeth or better. You know, gold teeth are good, but when it comes to cutting steel, you need carbide. So keep the gold teeth in your mouth and get the carbide teeth on your saw blade. And remember that the more teeth, the better. 60 teeth per inch is better than 30. And we're not cutting wood. This is not Bob Bila's workshop. This is Snody Knives, so keep the gall in your mouth. Put the carbide on these teeth. More teeth's better. So now we've got our blade profile traced. We've got the bar cut to length. The next step is to profile it. That's why they call this stock removal. This is stock removal. This is not, we're not forging, we're stock removal. So we're going to remove everything that's not the knife. It's real simple to do, guys. So now it's time to take this raw bar of steel and turn it into a knife. And the biggest transformation you'll see when knife making is your profile. It's instant gratification because we're going to go from this to a knife. Now, guys, remember the safety aspect of what we're doing. We're using a machine here that's an industrial high-powered machine with a 1.5 horsepower motor. It's moving at over 1,800 surface feet per minute. You need some good eyewear. Personally, I like Versace. It not only blocks out the UV rays, it also blocks out the hater rays. You don't need Versace. Just make sure you've got something that's got side protection. I'm going to turn this machine on. I'm going to show you how we do the stock removal profiling of our Snody Knives Boss. Like I was telling you guys, this is my favorite step of the knife making process because it's so rewarding to go from that bar of steel to a profiled knife that you can fit in your hand. You know, knives speak to people on an instinctive level. It's something that's in your DNA. If you're a man and you got red blood going through your blood veins, then knives speak to you. And if they don't, then I mean, nothing personal, but there's something wrong with you because cavemen used a knife to protect their people in the cave. It was the first weapon. And you got a woman in the cave, and you got some babies in there, and they're cooking some grease, and you got dinosaurs trying to get in, and all that you've got to defend yourself is a knife. That's why knives speak to people on an instinctual level. It's just something that's in your DNA. Okay, guys, now it's time to drill the lanyard hole. Let's talk a minute about safety here, and let's talk about this drill. You can go to Lowe's and buy an inexpensive drill for $99. It looks pretty innocent. It doesn't look like something that's capable of removing your finger or cutting one of your major arteries and putting you to sleep forever. I'm talking about just falling to sleep right here on the shop floor and not ever waking up. That's what this little unassuming machine will do to you. It will hurt you real bad. And they're wondering, why has Snody got these vice grips in his hand? Well, I've got these because we put these on the work table, and that prevents our workpiece from helicoptering. What you don't want to happen is you do not want that blade to make a full 360-degree revolution because it's building speed, 700, 800 RPMs. Heat-treated blade, razor-sharp edge, it hits your finger, and you lose your finger. And they probably are not going to be able to sew it back on. So let me show you. Now, don't try this at home. Let me show you why we're using that clamp. I'm going to show you what happens when you don't use the clamp and you're not paying attention. Now, we're going to come in and drill this lanyard hole. And you can feel that this workpiece is cracked. Did you see that? You see how hard that hit? And it's not even making a full 360-degree revolution. Let me show you how people lose their hand. They lose their hand when this thing goes all the way around like this. Look, and your phone rings, wham. You hit. See how hard that's hitting? That cuts your whole finger off. Don't do that, man. You need your fingers. Get you a C-clamp. I like these big vice grips. I can put them on right here. Look, put them on right here. Now when you set that blade up, set it up so it's touching that vice grip. See that? Now all I gotta do is come in here, drill that hole. It doesn't spin. Safety first, guys. Get you some good eye protection. I turn my phone off when we're doing this. I can't afford to lose a finger because somebody's calling wanting to know the difference between ATS-34 and BG-42. I'm here to answer your questions. They're important to me, but it's not so important to me that I'm willing to lose a finger or get one of my eyeballs knocked out because I'm distracted when the telephone rings. So all you people that freak out and call me and let the phone ring like 100 times, I want you to get a mental image of me standing here at this grind, at this machine, risking my life and limb while the phone is ringing over there, and I don't know what to do. I don't know whether I need to shut this down and go answer this guy's phone call. So, look, let the phone ring 5 times and then just call back later, okay? Now, let's go to the next step over here. Okay, guys, now it's time to separate the men from the boys. It's time to hollow grind the knife. We've laid the knife out, we've cut it to length, we've profiled our pattern. Now we've got something that looks and feels like a knife, but it's 1/8 inch thick. So what we have to do is come in, create a hollow grind. That's gonna be the basis for our edge cutting geometry. There's a reason that I'm the people's knife maker. There's a reason they call me the realist. I'm going to show you guys things that no other knife maker will show you. And I'm going to share some secrets with you. And I'm going to break some of the common myths that are out there. And the number one myth, and I'm going to tell you straight up, is that all of these accomplished knife makers that are 50, 60, 70 years old, they're all out there grinding by hand. That's what they tell you at the show, that they're grinding everything by hand. I'm not going to insult anybody. I'm not going to call them liars. That maybe they're just mistaken. Maybe they're confused. If you want to believe that, believe it. If you want to be that knife maker out there trying to cut his teeth, I already cut my teeth. If you're that guy out there trying to cut his teeth and you want to be tough and tell everybody you're grinding everything by hand, go ahead and do you. If you want to make money and be successful, then you're going to turn off your telephone right now and turn up the TV and you need to focus on what I'm fixing to show you. Because I'm fixing to show you how to make money. This is the secret right here to making the money. And these are simply plates that we fabricate. If you look right here, you can see I've got dozens and dozens and dozens of these plates. And I got little bitty ones. And I've got real big ones on every angle to accommodate every geometry that you can possibly imagine. And if we don't have the one we need, we just build another one. That's nothing but a thing for us. Let me tell you what, if you want to call yourself a custom knife maker and guarantee performance, then you have to have repeatability. And what that means is that every knife has to be the same thickness when it's finished. Every bevel has to be the same height. Originality is great in the handle. Originality is great when it comes to the sheath. But originality is not great when it comes to proven edge geometry. I need something that gives me a baseline so that I can compare my data and improve. Using my fixture plates allows me to do that. The fixture plate is also a heat sink. And we all know that we don't want to overheat this steel. This plate is pulling the heat away. So it's pretty simple. We've got our Boss Bushcraft blade here. I'm going to clamp it up. Get my pliers set so that they're on the proper. See, this ain't no Martha Stewart deal right here. This is real, man. We do this every day. The only difference is the camera's here today. This is real, man. I got to get my pliers dialed in. This is the same knife we started with this morning. Now you can see what we got going on here. Okay, that's one pass. The blade's halfway ground. Two passes. So what are we talking about? It's real time here, no editing. 10 seconds to grind a 3.5-inch blade. And it's perfect, guys. There ain't no flies on this. Now we're gonna put it in a heat treat oven, come back and refine the grind. Now let me show you the same operation, but by hand. Because that's what all these type A personalities want to talk about. I mean, they want to talk about grinding by hand. Well, we can do that too. If you're going to grind by hand, make you a little push stick. There's no need to burn the ends of your fingers off. That's not working smart, okay? You need to work smart. You need to be smart if you're going to do this. Get your push stick and come in there. That doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how hard I push or how fast I try to work. It's simply impossible for me to grind as fast and as accurately by hand. Guys, it's up to you. That's basically the two methods. You can completely freehand them. Takes a little bit longer. You know, you're going to burn the ends of your fingers off. The blades are not going to be consistent. Your neck's going to hurt more. Your arms are going to hurt more. You got to strain your eyes more. It's more demanding. Just generally a lot less fun. Or you can block up and do like we do, because this is not about ego. This is about giving our clients the very best quality available. And there's a reason that repeatability and ANSI standards are in place throughout the aircraft industry, the petroleum industry, et cetera, et cetera. You have to have a benchmark to establish what kind of performance you're getting. And if you're in here grinding completely freehand and every blade is different, then you really don't have a benchmark. And let me show you real quick how to utilize one of our larger blocks here. In fact, let me show you how to do a big knife on a little block, okay? Because a lot of people, they're really confused about this. And they really don't understand the dynamics here of what we're doing. So let me show you how we can use this small block. And this is a double ground Texas Hunter boot knife. The thing I like about these blocks is I can push very hard and it pulls all the heat away from the blade and I don't burn my fingers. While I'm grinding, see that grind line? That's what people are paying for. They don't want crooked grind lines. They want straight, plain bevels. I've been doing this 16 years, and my only goal is to produce the finest edge cutlery available anywhere in the world. we build blocks to accommodate our grinding, to facilitate our grinding, to improve our grinding, to give us repeatability, consistent results. See, I can actually think about other things while I'm grinding here. I can think about my new set of diamond teeth I'm having made. I can think about my next chain. Think about the fried shrimp I'm gonna eat tonight. You guys do it however you want, man. Like I said, there's a reason they call me the realest maker in the game. And that's because I'm the only one out there that's gonna tell you the truth about how this is done. The other guys, they're too insecure to tell you the truth about how they're doing this. Okay, we've got our blade laid out, profiled, drilled, the bevel's ground. Now it's time to take you in the other room and show you how we put our trademark handle on. Okay, guys, it's time to heat treat our blade. And as I mentioned earlier, when we purchase the steel, it's in the annealed state. It's still soft. What we want to do is we want to convert it into a martensitic type steel that has the attributes desirable for performance cutlery, i.e. edge retention, the ability to take a very keen edge geometry. And that's dependent upon the hardness of the base metal. So the first thing we do is we build a package. And this looks like aluminum foil, but it's actually stainless steel. It's a high temperature stainless. So we come in and we cut this material with some heavy duty scissors. And you want to be real careful. You can really cut yourself bad with this material. Basically, you're going to cut your pouch, make it just a little bit bigger than the blade. You fold it over. We like to fold all of our seams twice, and you end up with a package that looks like this. Now, the purpose of this package is to protect this blade from the ambient oxygen, because if this metal gets up to 1800 degrees and it's exposed to oxygen, then it's going to lose a bunch of carbon and bad things are going to happen. If you've ever seen a piece of lava rock, that's what happens when this steel is exposed to oxygen at 1800, 1900, 2000 degrees. So insert the blade into your package. Gently take it down to the bottom. Like I said, I like to make two folds when I do this. And then I'll use something to go over the second fold. I'm just gonna walk you over to the oven and show you what we do here. This goes into my heat treat furnace. We have a program, it's a proprietary program. It basically takes the metal from ambient temperature, which is about 80 degrees today. This particular blade steel, I'm going to take up to 1,975 degrees. So we run it up to 1,975 degrees. We'll soak it for 20 minutes. And then we pull it out and we quench right here on our aluminum quench plates. Now you see my five-year-old son's been out here and set a bunch of calipers here that don't belong here. You got to move the calipers. You bring the blade over here, quench it, and then we've got a blade that we can take out of the package and begin to finish. So we come out of the package. Now this is a very handy vise right here. It's what I use to put my handles on. So we're going to put the knife blade into the jaws of the vise and tighten it. We're going to get a roll of our, this is 550 paracord. We use the 3M Tracer reflective card for this project. And I know that I need about 7 feet of this to do what I want to do here. I'm going to strip the core out of this cord, guys. Like I said, I'm going to show you things that some of the other guys won't show you. But go ahead and strip the core out of this 550 cord. And you want to make a real clean cut on the end of it. The sharp knife. Okay, guys, this is how we wrap our handles. And we're using 550 cord, but our goal here is to have a permanent handle. We want a permanent monolithic type handle. So just put a little drop of super glue down. Just giving that just a couple of seconds. I'm going to come back around. The super glue's got it tacked down for me. Now here's where the spinning vise comes in handy. Is you can pivot it both directions and make sure you're laying your cord down in a nice tight pattern. You want to use a lot of pressure. I'm pulling on this real hard as I wrap it. I'm going in front and then I'm pulling back. So I'm pulling down tightly and I'm pulling back towards me with quite a bit of force. I don't know, maybe 60 pounds, 60, 70. Okay, now this is the important part. I'm getting up to the front. And this is what's going to show. So take a minute here and get you a straight wrap across the front. And then break it back off of that. Now you can see here how I've stopped that with a nice straight wrap up at the front, up at the ricasso area. Now it's pretty simple. We're just going to come back. We're going to keep wrapping this tightly. The grip retention on this type of handle is absolutely incredible. It is. I honestly, we build knives out of everything you can imagine, from carbon fiber, mother of pearl, petrified dinosaur bone, G10. I use all of the phenolics, micartas. And I'm here to tell you right now, this clamp, keep one of these clamps handy, because see, right now I need to clamp this off, okay? Clamp that off, cut you another little piece. Well, you know what we'll do? We'll just take this cordage that came out of the inside, and we'll use this piece to terminate this wrap. So you need to keep one of these clamps handy. You don't know, you might get a phone call. You've spent 15, 20 minutes working on this handle. The phone rings, you're gonna lose it all. Okay, you're gonna get down to the end and then you're gonna back up one wrap and you're gonna lay this in. Just like that. I'm gonna come around, I'm gonna make another wrap over that. And I'm going to bring my tag end through this eye that I've created. Okay. Now you got to hold this down while you can't just turn loose. Okay. You got to keep tension on that. Okay. So hold that down and keep tension on it. Now you need to grab your super glue because this thing is just going to fall apart if you don't. Now you need to put a drop of glue right here to anchor this. Give the glue just a second to anchor that wrap so that you don't lose everything. And then come in and pull that end under. See, okay, now it's Now you got to be gentle. Now it's come under and gently pull it through without distorting your wrap. Now you're going to come back and see, that's not very straight right now. Well, watch this. You come in and push that thing up, and you can get it perfect. See that? You comb this wrap, and it'll lay down. Get your wrap looking nice, professional, tight. Come in, give the super glue time to completely dry, okay, before you cut this. Cut that off, and then come in with your lighter. Burn that end off, and then just run the lighter up and down the handle so that it catches any of the little fuzz or any of the frays. We're almost through now. We've got the handle wrapped. Now, the final step is one they don't want you to see. That's the step in which we encapsulate this in an epoxy, which makes it a permanent weatherproof handle. So we're going to move over to the other table. We're going to mix up some epoxy and show you how we do that. Okay, it's time to mix our epoxy and treat our 550 cord handle. This step that I'm about to show you, it actually transforms the 550 cord into a monolithic handle. It is impervious to moisture and very, very durable. So I start out, I use a Aquafina bottle for this. You can use anything you want. I just split water bottles. Depending on how much resin I'm gonna mix, I'll come in and make a mark here. And this is a two-part epoxy. What you're looking at here costs about $300 for a gallon. It's a high-performance resin that's actually made by a company that specializes in fishing equipment. So I'm going to start with my hardener because it's very important that you've got enough hardener in the equation. And we'll put the resin in. We're just gonna fill it up to the red mark here that I've made. It's real simple. You've got a lot of different coatings out there. Basically, there's two types of coatings. You've got coatings that cure through oxygen-induced polymerization, and you have coatings that cure through chemically-induced polymerization. This resin is an example of a product that cures through chemically-induced polymerization. And what that means is when I start mixing these two compounds together, there's going to be a chemical reaction take place, which is going to create heat. And the heat is going to activate the hardener, and it's going to do something that in the coating world we call kick. They say kick. It's going to kick off. And when it kicks off, you're only going to have a couple of minutes to work with it until it solidifies. So it's very important that you mix this properly. Whenever I think it's mixed, I go ahead and stir it about an additional 100 times. That's pretty much my philosophy with knife making. Whenever I think I'm done with something, I just go back and do it a little bit more. The resin, the epoxy mixture will become clear. You want to try not to induce too many air bubbles into it. I'm going to let it sit for about 5 seconds here and let it completely kick off before I... Yeah, the temperature's already rising. It's warming up pretty quickly. So what I do is I just drop the knife in there. I reach down with my carbon fiber coating tool and we coat the handle. Now, the idea here is to get the resin to really soak in. You want to make sure you put a lot of resin up here at the front because we want that completely sealed off. That's a source of corrosion. That's a place that moisture could get in and compromise the handle. So we've completely coated this. Now we're going to pull it out, and we're just going to lay it here on a sheet of notebook paper. We're going to let it lay there for a minute, and that's going to allow the resin to fully penetrate the 550 cord and go all the way down to the steel. So we keep a towel nearby, a rag nearby. We've let this sit here now for a few seconds. The resin has penetrated the handle. We want it to look natural. We want it to look like these that have already been done. So we've got to get the excess resin off. And the best way to do that is just like this. Just lay it in a towel and gently remove the resin from the steel. Take your time. Have pride in your workmanship here. And I just put pressure on it. I kind of pat it. Don't want to rub on it too much. What we want to do is get all of the excess resin off, but leave that resin underneath the cord. You want it completely saturated. So basically that's what we've got. That's looking pretty outstanding. Now, if you lay this down, it's going to take 18 hours to cure, so it's going to glue itself to whatever it's touching. So that's where my other trick of the day comes in. Get you a catalog, insert it in the page, and you're good to go. Now, you can come back in 18 hours, and you're going to have this. Rock hard. Check this out. You cannot get this off. It's completely monolithic. Cannot be removed. It's an extraordinary grip. Now I'm going to take you over and show you the final step now, and that's putting the edge on, sharpening the edge. And we're very proud of the cutting ability of our knives. We spent 16 years refining this next operation that I'm about to share with you. This is the first time I've shared my sharpening methods in public, okay? So here we go. We're going to finish this boss. We're going to put the edge on it. One thing I want to touch on briefly is sharpening. Sharpening. About once a week, I get a professional sharpener that contacts me. He's like, hey, Mike, I want to sharpen your knives. But what a lot of people don't understand is that the first time that we sharpen a knife here in the knife shop, we're working with a thickness of about 10 thousandths of an inch. We have to remove metal. We got to create a bevel on there. These sharpeners out there, these hobbyist sharpeners, many of which are very professional and they're my friends and they get great results. Guys, they're working with a knife blade that's already been sharpened. They're restoring a previously sharpened edge. We're knife makers. We're working with a piece of steel that's never seen an edge. So we got to go in there and cut these micro bevels. That's where the ceramic belts come in. They cost about $15 a piece, but they cut very aggressively and they don't generate any heat. When you step up to a machine that's moving 1400 surface feet per minute and you're working with an air hardening steel, you got to be very careful that you don't exceed the temperature when you put your edge on. We're tempering this steel at 400 degrees. That means I do not want to get it up to 400 degrees. In fact, I don't even want to get it up to 200 degrees. So I'm going to put the primary bevel edge on. I'm going to show you how I do that. I'm going to show you what they're talking about when they say a burr. I'm going to show you how to see the burr pop up, and then I'm going to show you how to take it off and create a scary sharp edge, absolutely surgical, scary sharp. Quick safety tip, when you turn these belt grinders on, move to the side, because if the belt breaks or a wheel flies off, you don't want it hitting you in the head. Move over to the side and turn the thing on. We're going to show you, I want to take a second here and show you what's happening. Now, if you can see this reflective burr popping up right here, it's starting about here, and it's running to the tip. And it looks like a piece of aluminum foil shining on there. I like to work from the middle of the blade out to the tip and get my burr in that area and then start working it back to the ricasso, because one thing I can't stand is a knife that's dished out back here, because the knife maker took off too much metal back here sharpening it. I like for my knives to taper out right here and this line to basically be straight. So you should be able to see that shiny burr right there that's popped up. And it goes from the tip to right here. Now I'm going to turn the machine back on and I'm going to carry that burr all the way back here to the choil. And then I'm going to go over it one time and make it consistent. Then we'll walk next door and I'll use the buffer and we will strop this burr off. Okay, so here we go. Okay, let me get this in the light so that it's reflecting this burr and you can see this thing now. It's standing up all the way here. That's what they talk about when they say the wire edge or the burr. Guys, to get a knife blade sharp, you've got to get a burr. Before anything else, you've got to get a burr. Now, what you're looking at here is one of my Crisis chisel grinds. It's basically sharpened on one side. There's a lot of confusion about chisel grinds. Let me make it real simple, guys, okay? Here's a double grind. This is a V grind. Here's a chisel grind. Here's a V grind. Here's a chisel grind. Okay, guys are like, the chisel grind won't cut straight. Hey, turn it 10 degrees, and what do you got? A V grind. So V grind, chisel grind. When you take this geometry and you cut it in half, you increase cutting performance. Guys, a straight razor cuts a lot better than an axe. When you go from this to this to this, it increases cutting performance. It's just part of the equation. So we're going to take this burr off and finish this knife up. So we're here in the buffing room, and it's time to buff the burr off. And guys, you've all seen the barber with his strop. What he's doing is he's aligning the edge and he's taking this burr off. There's a lot of ways to do this, and I want to tell you right now, I do not recommend trying this at home. This buffer has put a lot of people in the emergency room, and it's cut off a lot of fingers, and it's taken a lot of talented craftsmen, and it's turned them into people that just have nubs on their hands. So if you decide to use a buffer, please, please research it and proceed with extreme caution. Okay, we've got that burr buffed off here. Now we're gonna flip it over and touch it on the back side. I'm going to come back and I'm going to buff out that whole bevel now and just clean, make the whole thing nice and shiny. Wham. And that's it right there. Now, when we talk about sharp, there's lots of definitions of sharp. I don't do a lot of shaving. I'm going to do a little bit right here just to show you what we're talking about. If I did this daily with my knife, if you build knives as long as I have, you really don't have to do this because you know what the result's gonna be. But this is treetop shaving, guys, here. If you can see that, the blade's not touching my skin. And it's treetop shaving. So there's a lot of things you'd probably rather see than a grown man with gold teeth shaving, but I want you to understand the reason that this has that edge is because we've buffed it. We've polished it off. It's an infinite edge that is capable of splitting atoms. I'm talking about sharp here, man. So we're going to go next door and clean this knife up, put a lanyard on it, and it's going to be ready to send out to a client. Hey, let's talk about sharpening sharp knives and exactly what that means here to us at Snody Knives. When we build a small knife like the Boss, we're looking for an extremely high-performance edge. When I say high-performance, I'm talking about a thin edge geometry that's capable of really, really cutting. So one of the tests that I look for is, can you take the knife and cut print off of a piece of paper without cutting through? Can you cut these letters off without cutting through? Okay, well, I just passed that test. We've cut the letter off. We know this will shave. That's kind of a silly test. Let's see what it'll do on paracord. Let's double this over, 4, 8, okay, here's 16. This is 16 pieces of paracord here. This paracord's a little more abrasive than your standard. It's the 3M reflective cord. I'm just going to come straight down. That's 16 pieces right there, guys. And let's do that again so you can see there's not much sawing motion at all. I'm just going to come straight down. Paper, I don't know. Paper's kind of boring. A lot of people talk about circle cuts. I see a lot of guys cutting magazines, and that's impressive. Here is a freaking book I had when I was working in Russia, Soviet Union. Foreign policy. It's 228 pages thick. And I'm gonna see if we can cut through it, man. 228 pages with the Snody Boss. That's what I'm talking about right there, man. We're talking about sharp, huh? Let me show you again just how that worked. Man, this is all real too, guys. This is not staging this at all, man. I'm gonna do this one with one hand. Now, the reason we round the spine on these knives is so you can put your thumb out there and utilize the Filipino grip. I can't get a 3.5-inch knife to perform much better than that for you guys. And believe me, I'm doing everything I can to get all the performance we can get. Lay this across Lincoln's head. Let me see. I want to split Lincoln in half in one stroke.